you everyone for joining. We're about to start, so please find your seats. Distinguished delegates, we are starting our On the Road to Lisbon, and I invite you all to watch a short movie to get us inspired for our conversation. Thank you very much. And before the movie and the short video, we will have our speakers, and the video will come a bit later. So hi, I am Leticia Carvalho, head of Marine and Freshwater Branch, United Nations Environment Program. And I will serve as your moderator. It's my great pleasure to be here today to welcome Excellencies, distinguished delegates, participants, and guests for the side event hosted by Kenya and Portugal, UN Ocean Conference on the Road to Lisbon. To open the session, I invite the Honorable Ambassador Macharia Kamau, Principal Secretary, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Kenya, for his remarks. Ambassador, we are so honored to have you here today and are aware of your exemplary leadership in co-chairing the negotiations that successfully concluded the Sustainable Development Goals. We are indeed so fortunate to have your wisdom and experience to support efforts to achieve the SDG 14, Life Below Water. Ambassador Macharia, I welcome you to the stage.
Thank you very much, Leticia. It really is my singular pleasure to be here. It's always wonderful to see the same group of people who are pushing for these great changes that we need to see in our world, always coming together at every opportunity that they get. And for those of us who've gone from visionary, we once thought we were leaders who were believing in change and planetary affairs, to being an administrator, it's really refreshing to be back among you. And it gives me really great pleasure to be here. Kenya, of course, is terribly excited about the whole Road to Lisbon event. We are really looking forward to the United Nations Oceans Conference, and you know, we just cannot wait for us to consolidate the world around the challenges that we face for oceans, for our planet in general. I'm really delighted to be here today. Of course, with the UNEP Executive Director, Miss Inga Anderson, who has been, of course, the leader of this great institution that we call UNEP. We are here, of course, with Ambassador Pedro Moutinho de Almeida. Ambassador, it's great to see you, of the Portuguese Organizing Committee, with whom we have been working. And of course, my great friend and colleague in arms, Ambassador Peter Thompson, the UN Secretary General Special Envoy for Oceans, among many, many other distinguished leadership roles that he has had, and my colleague from the Ministry of Fisheries, who's representing the Principal Secretary from the Ministry of Fisheries, is also here to deliver his remarks. We had a very exciting decision that came out of UNGA this year, which was the scaling up of ocean action based on science, innovation for the implementation of Global 14, which Peter always wears on him at all times. I can see he's still got it on today. This has really enhanced the potential for us to deliver a very unique conference in Lisbon, and we're really truly looking forward to that. And this, the fifth session of the United Nations Environmental Assembly, is yet another opportunity for us as member states and stakeholders to share best practices for sustainability and create the momentum that we need to put behind governments to get where we need to be. In this context, I would like just to reiterate what we truly believe, that the ocean, seas, and marine resources, lakes and rivers, are really an integral part of the post-COVID world recovery effort. We're just not gonna get there if we leave any of these aspects of our planet behind. And the ocean continues to provide, as we all know, the great system that keeps our weather patterns functional, provides our water sources. It really is as many people have said, we shouldn't be called Earth, we should be called water, because there's just so much of it, a lot more than there is the Earth itself. And we need to give the oceans the dignity that it deserves to be. As we ourselves continue to grow our populations and our economies, we have seen the increased pressure and the threats that have been faced in our natural resources, leading to the kind of challenges that we are facing with pollution, climate change, and habitat destruction. This is nothing new to any of you, because you are literally the people who are driving this agenda. But it's always good to remind ourselves that that's the business that we're in. And since we adopted the SDGs, we have made incredible efforts to try to scale up and understand better the linkages and the interactions among the SDGs, recognizing the centrality of oceans as part of that effort. SDG 14 aims to make sure that we take several bold measures in the right direction to achieve what we need to achieve for 2025. We need, as we have just said, as I've just said a little earlier, reduce pollution, promote conservation and sustainable use of marine resources, implementing the international laws that are anchored in UNCLOS, and making sure that we really do have a planet that recognizes the value of these very oceans that are so singularly important to life on Earth. Now, we in Kenya have continued to prioritize oceans and the blue economy resources as we ourselves anchor those very issues on Vision 2030, our own economic blueprint for achieving blue growth in our own country. And we in Kenya have been keen to fully realize the potential. We have 140,000 square kilometers of exclusive economic zone, and we are looking to see how we can best match that and protect it as a way of attaining our commitments towards SDG 14. We also have been trying to galvanize and consolidate the much needed political impetus to prioritize the acceleration towards the goals that we need for ocean action in the world. We recognize the challenges that we face. And I must say, I was just speaking to Inga a little earlier, and I mentioned the plastics agreement. And I'm really glad to hear of the progress that's actually been achieved through last night, right? Because just 2 days ago, I was reading in the Financial Times, you know, that there was really an effort by those who don't seem to share our passion around these issues to stop this particular agreement from going through. So I want to congratulate those of you who have been pushing this plastics agreement and pushing it through. And the fact that it's happening here in Nairobi is a proud moment for us as Kenyans, as people who believe in UNEP, and wish it all the very success. As many of you know, in 2018, we had our our Blue Economy Conference here, the Sustainable Blue Economy Conference. We were working with Japan, we were working in Canada, we worked with very many other partners. And really, what we have seen since then is that there's a real intensity around this issue of what the blue economy can avail for all of us. And we adopted the Nairobi Statement of Intent, which we have been working on. In addition, our own president, who has been the champion of these issues, and I'm not saying that because he's my boss, I'm saying that because indeed he is truly keen on these matters. He has been in the high-level panel on sustainable oceans economy, which is committed to putting sustainability at the heart of oceans management to the benefit of all people, nature, and our economies. As I conclude, I would like just to remind us all again that we have not made really the great progress that we have promised ourselves. We are seeing real weaknesses in our ability to deliver on some of these great actions that we need to undertake to achieve what we are trying to achieve. And some of the areas that concern us include the lack of public and private sector funding for innovative maritime technologies. We have said it time and again, without the right technology transfer, without the right investments in developing countries, which are an integral part of what we hope to achieve for global outcomes, we are simply not going to get there. And investments in these areas remain a real challenge. I mean, only 2% of the Green Climate Fund has been allocated to oceans projects, for example. Only 2%. Where has the other 98% gone to that could be more important than oceans themselves? I'd like that question answered. Only 1.6% of the official development assistance, ODA, supports the oceans economy, recognizing how many countries there are in the world, islands and ocean-facing countries that need this assistance. Where is the rest of that money going to? And why are the other sectors getting prioritized and not oceans? SDG 14, basically the ocean, is the least funded of the SDGs from our assessment. And that's problematic. We need to find a way to make sure that the resources that are needed are put behind this great challenge that we are facing for planet Earth. However, there are examples of innovative financing models that exist. We all believe that we can engage in both traditional and new partnerships arrangements to make sure that we have greater funding coming to the oceans. And so, in the spirit of leaving no one behind, I wish to call for support from all our partners, both private and public, to scale up collaboration efforts in order to forge meaningful, replicable, and transformative partnerships, because that's really what we need to do. Similarly, we as governments need to allocate funds to maritime and marine research, as well as innovative projects within our own national budgets. And we have challenged ourselves in Kenya, and we would love to see other countries do the same. We will, of course, continue to give our unwavering support to the road to Lisbon. We want to build up on what Fiji and Sweden did in the first efforts to bring the attention of the world around this issue of oceans. And we ourselves want to make sure that this, the second United Nations Oceans Conference, is truly the transformative event that we all aspire for. After the silence that COVID had put on us for the last 2 or 3 years, this will be a great comeback for planet Earth. At that point, I will stop. And thank you most sincerely for being in Nairobi, for being in Kenya, for being here at UNEP, and for being the soldiers of the oceans that you are. We appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Masharia. And now, without further delay, let me invite Executive Director, Mrs. Inger Andersen, to take the floor.
Thank you so much. And as I start, let me just say that the lady who's standing next to me is the one who's been up negotiating till 3 a.m. for 7 days, together with many others, supporting the team. And we are very, very proud to have Leticia amongst us. I will observe all protocol with your permission, because in 12 minutes we are having the press conference for IPCC, launching the new report. But since we are launching the new report, I invite you all to take one deep breath in and exhale. And that breath was given to you by the oceans, because every second breath you take is produced by the oceans. And if we do not understand that, we do not understand how our oxygen is created. The other breath is produced by the green. And it is these two miracles on our planet, on the one hand the oceans, and on the other hand the terrestrial ecology, that enables life on Earth. And so when we know that oceans are these innocents who will take up the carbon that we put into the atmosphere, when we understand that 20 to 30% of all carbon is just absorbed by the oceans, thereby causing acidification, essentially turning the oceans into soda water or carbonated water, that is the future that the oceans cannot take. And at the same time, while we are causing acidification, we are pushing in plastics and other toxics into the oceans, and we are obviously causing warming, thereby causing our oceans to warm. That destroys biodiversity, that has a destruction on the marine environment, and we understand that there are millions of people, we just heard from C.S. Macharia, who rely on these oceans for their daily bread. And so we cannot treat the oceans like the global trash can. We cannot have 80% of all fertilizers ending into the oceans, causing dead zones and all the associated problems. We understand, and the often repeated statistics, that one dump truck per minute is dumping its plastic into the oceans. So this has a ripple effect on everything. And the blue economy is part and parcel of the solution. And that is why, as you chart the road to Lisbon and beyond, we need to take certain steps. What do we need to do? We need to get serious about climate change. We made some promises in COP27. Now is the time to deliver, and deliver expeditiously, because delay is no longer an option. Climate change, biodiversity loss, and pollution and waste are essentially pulling the rug from under the SDGs that we just heard C.S. Macharia was a key architect of. What do we need to do on the road to Lisbon? We need to get the biodiversity post-2020 framework right. This is in negotiation as we speak. Yes, by all means, 30 by 30 or even more. I say 100 by 100. Why? Because we need to have biodiversity in cities, in your backyards, on our farms. This is not something behind a fence. This is how we need to live, making sure that there's equity, intergenerational justice, and indeed understanding that transfer of technology and finance has to be part of the equation. So what do we need to do as we come on the road to Lisbon? What do we need to do? We need to address plastic pollution, and that, ladies and gentlemen, will be done here in Nairobi, God willing, come the gavel going down on Wednesday, when we will hopefully have an agreement from source to sea, the entire circular economy dealing with plastic pollution, including the means of implementation and financing. So what do we need to do as we chart the road to Lisbon? We need to begin to construct a circular economy, an economy that does not have the damaging lifestyles. We need to ensure that as we take things out of the belly of the earth, which we need to do to live, and we put them into the economy, they stay in the economy. We do not throw it back into the environment as trash. That's what we need to do. So what do we need to do on the road to Lisbon? We need to rethink harmful subsidies. We need to understand that unsustainable fisheries subsidies, unsustainable agricultural and carbon subsidies can no longer be the way. In fact, we need to flip them to be nature positive, have zero pollution and climate net zero. What do we need to do? We need to deliver on the decade for restoration. That is a rallying cry to heal the planet. And what do we need to do? I speak to you from beautiful UNEP at our 50th anniversary. And here is what we saw in the 70s. My predecessor helped the world establish the Regional Seas Program. That is a program that lands much of this work after the economy conference, after the Oceans Conference delegates go home, the hard work through the regional seas will begin. So friends, the road to Lisbon is not a long road, but it is a road filled with opportunities to get things right. And we can do this because, as 20th century Japanese writer Runyosuke once said, individually, we're just one drop. Together, we are an ocean. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, here we are. Let me take my seat here. Thank you, eminent speakers. You were so compelling. And with that, it's clear that this moment is on the road to Lisbon is about raising the clarion call for the role of our ocean in navigating a new course. And with that said, I can't think of more powerful voice on this matter than Mr. Peter Townsend, UN Secretary General Special Envoy for Ocean. I would like to invite you to take the floor and inspire us.
Thank you, Leticia, and excuse me for taking the podium, but I actually sat up late last night writing this speech, so I think I'll read it to you all. But look, it's great to be back in Nairobi and to see you all face to face again. And many thanks to UNEP, great job done. But my sincere thanks to the government people of Kenya. And I really take my hat off to them and to Portugal. For their commitment in the preparations for the UN Ocean Conference over the last, 4 to 5 years, and the conference is only 4 months away now. So I was at the center of the organization of the first UN Ocean Conference, and now having had the privilege of working with Portugal and Kenya on the next UN Ocean Conference, I've got no doubt that Lisbon will raise the bar on action to conserve and sustainably use the ocean's resources. You've all heard the mantra, no healthy planet without a healthy ocean. And the ocean's health is measurably in decline. Our task is to stop that decline and apply ourselves thereafter to the full restoration of its health. The former can be achieved, and please listen to this, the former can be achieved in 2022. The latter, unfortunately, is a longer haul for our children and grandchildren to deal with because of the onflow of the effects of greenhouse gases. So in their collective wisdom, the member states have called for the UN Ocean Conference to produce the solutions we require, rooted in science and innovation and partnerships. And part of my utter confidence in achieving the desired outcomes of the Lisbon Conference is the emergence already of the called for solutions. I mentioned that we can stop the decline of the ocean's health this year. That's not a glib statement. It's a very doable act, and I'll explain how we can do it. The Friends of Ocean Action, a Geneva-based body of ocean activists and experts that I co-chair, issued a Stop the Decline statement in January that was conveyed to all our governments, and I'm pleased to see, and I noticed this at the One Ocean Summit in Brest, for example, I'm pleased to see that the speeches of many of our leaders are already incorporating the statement's central point. And the central point is that if consensus is achieved to do the right thing at just 6 multilateral meetings this year, 2022 will indeed be the year we stop the decline. The 6 meetings are UNEA 5.2 in Nairobi. Plastic pollution has been befouling the ocean at unconscionable levels, with the geographically comprehensive permeation of microplastics presenting unknown hazards for nature and for us. So the mandating of negotiations for an international treaty to stop plastic pollution presents the turning point to end the plastic plague. So we're tantalizingly close to that day, and hopefully we'll get the job done with alacrity and ratify a treaty as if our children's lives depend on it, because they probably do. Secondly, the second meeting. The World Trade Organization Ministerial Conference will meet in mid-June in Geneva, and the removal of harmful fisheries subsidies is long-standing business for the Council to act upon. These subsidies have been described by many experts as the most damaging thing we do to the marine environment, spending $20 to $30 billion per annum of public funds, basically for the enjoyment of industrial fishing fleets to go out and strip the ocean of depleting resources. Imagine those funds going instead to environmentally friendly projects like seaweed farming or other forms of sustainable agriculture. This is low-hanging fruit, and the credibility of the WTO system is at stake if member states cannot achieve this one. Do the right thing in Geneva in June, and the WTO will have ticked the box on SDG 14.6. The third meeting is the Intergovernmental Conference on Marine Biodiversity Beyond National Jurisdiction, the so-called BB&J conference, which gets underway next week in New York. After the hiatus of the COVID pandemic, the conclusion in New York of a robust and operable treaty for governance of the high seas is very achievable in 2022. And will be a key piece in the jigsaw of stopping the decline. I use words like very achievable, not again in a glib way. People like Ambassador Kamau and I have been in those halls late at night, as you have been over the last week, and these things are achievable if we just grasp the nettle and do what we're expected to do, what we're paid to do, actually. So fifthly, there is the UN Ocean Conference itself in Lisbon, from 27 June to 1st July, at which the world will be launching a game-changing, science-based fleet of solutions, innovations, and partnerships at the conference itself, and in the vibrant events which run in tandem, including the High-Level Water Symposium, bringing together the fresh and salt water communities to produce source-to-sea solutions, the Youth Forum, and the Sustainable Blue Economy Investment Forum, the latter being held in close proximity to Lisbon at Nova University in Cascais. Continuing the great journey begun here in Nairobi in November 2018 at the Sustainable Blue Economy Conference. The sixth and last meeting is UNFCCC's COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh in November, where we will witness or not the provision of the finance necessary for realistic climate change adaptation to occur. At COP27, critical to the ocean's health will be that we see the climate finance needle moving substantively in the direction of the sustainable blue economy. I'll say more on why that is critical if there's time for me to do so today or in the corridors. I should mention that 2022 is also the International Year of the Artisanal Fisheries and Aquaculture, and that last year the UN launched the Decade of Ocean Science for Sustainable Development and the Decade of Ecosystem Restoration to support and advance the realization of the 2030 Agenda. Many of you will also know that a solid outcome of last November's UNFCCC COP26 in Glasgow was to build ocean considerations into UNFCCC's ongoing work, which is expected to lead to solid progress with further negotiations in mid-June in Bonn to address issues such as ocean warming and acidification. These in turn will improve the ocean's health and secure its unique capacity to sequester carbon. So in conclusion, it's vital that the international community does not squander the unparalleled opportunities presented by this confluence of attention on the need for decisive ocean action. Do the right thing, grasp the nettle of consensus, and 2022 will go down in history as the year we stopped the decline of the ocean's health. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Peter. Thanks for taking us to the road. And let me now invite and introduce Mrs. Lucy Obungo, Acting Fisheries and Blue Economy Secretary of the Ministry of Agriculture, Livestock, Fisheries and Cooperatives of Kenya. And it's my great pleasure to ask you to tell us more about Kenyan views, these opportunities, policy frameworks, and what the government is doing to help to alleviate poverty through increasing capacity for coastal communities. You have the floor, madam.
Thank you very much. Excellencies, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, all protocols observed. I'm here on behalf of my principal secretary, Dr. Francis Otieno Owino, who was unable to be here. So I'll read his remarks. I'm honored to be part of this panel co-hosted by Kenya and UNEP, and would like to highlight key action areas that Kenya is focusing on as it works towards strengthening actions for nature to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. My reflections are drawn from the participants and collaborative work of the high-level panel, the Commonwealth Blue Charter, UN Nairobi Convention, African Union, and many regional bodies of which Kenya is a key member nation. In the area of ocean health, we are committed to the reduction of greenhouse gases, prevention of the loss of biodiversity, and restoration and protection of marine ecosystems. In this area, our commitment is clear through the numerous pioneering restoration efforts undertaken in renewable energy, mangroves, seagrasses, and coral reefs. As a nation, we have recently updated our nationally determined contribution from 30% to 32% by 2030, in line with our Sustainable Development Agenda. In addition to several priority mitigation actions, such as increasing the use of renewable energy, we have included coastal carbon systems, payment for ecosystem services as part of our mitigation actions. These actions include support for implementation of the National Mangrove Management Plan and support for continuous assessments of blue carbon ocean-based ecosystems so that they can be included in the nationally determined contributions in the future. One of the most pressing questions of our time is how we can continue to produce nutritious food, jobs, revenues for the current and projected global population of 10 billion in coming decades in an already resource-constrained world. We in Kenya continue to focus on protecting and restoring marine and coastal ecosystems. Kenya is moving towards enhancing of effective area-based conservation measures that include the establishment of joint co-management areas along the coast for the protection of biodiversity, while also delivering climate, food, socioeconomic, and cultural benefits. In order to safeguard our coastal resources, the government established the Kenya Fisheries Service and Kenya Coast Guard Service to protect marine resources and secure its territorial waters. During the next 5 to 10 years, Kenya will be implementing blue economy projects in the whole theme of healthy ocean and sustainable development for mankind. This will include modernization of Kenyan ports, fish landing sites as gateways for fisheries infrastructure, training Kenyans to participate in all aspects of its emerging blue economy activities, promotion of aquaculture development, as well as protection of aquatic and coastal environment. Promotion of ocean equity remains at the heart of our interventions, with the desire to ensure that all Kenyans benefit from the blue economy, resources, and spaces. As a nation, we are embarking on the development of a marine spatial plan, which will collate the views of all stakeholders and provide space for Kenyans to make use of their ocean space. Investment in harnessing ocean data and building capacity to understand and manage the oceans is key for sustainable utilization. We have established a hub for data and information sharing that is coordinated through the Intergovernmental Oceanographic Commission's International Ocean Data Information Exchange at one of our research institutes. This is the Kenya Marine and Fisheries Research Institute. Data from research is used to guide fisheries policy and management interventions in the sector. This link is key to ensuring that oceans are protected on the strength of data that guides policy and management actions. The reduction of ocean co-pollution remains at the forefront of our quest for the establishment of clean oceans. As a country, we continue to work with our citizens to reduce plastic waste. I think everybody who has talked to you today has mentioned plastic waste, so it's a key aspect of our intervention too. And we have seen the enactment of the enforcement of progressive legislations to ban single-use plastics and use of plastic bottles in specific ecosystems to reduce plastic litter from our ecosystem, from our beaches, parks, national reserves, and marine protected areas. Education and awareness campaigns remain critical for our success. We have targeted various segments of our population, including school-going children, and experienced tremendous behavior and awareness. I thank you.
Thank you very much. What an honor and pleasure to hear about Kenya's vision and as a beacon and leadership on sustainable blue economy and to prevent and combat plastic pollution. Let me now also use this opportunity to applaud Kenya for being the one of the first 10 countries to join the UN United Nations Clean Seas Campaign in 2017. And now it's a great pleasure also to announce that today Cabo Verde, Rwanda, and Uganda are also joining the Clean Seas Campaign and using this platform to express their commitments towards a world without plastic pollution. So, what a leadership of Africa. And with that, let me now invite the remarks of His Excellency Ambassador Pedro Moutinho de Almeida, Chair of the Portuguese Organizing Committee of the United Nations Ocean Conference. Ambassador Moutinho,
thank you.
Por favor.
From,
Good morning to you all. Let me first start by thanking Ambassador Kamau for the welcoming in Kenya. This is, I have been here almost exactly 30 years ago on my way to Mogadishu with the European Union Troika Ministerial meeting. I was then not a young, but a younger Africa director, and my stay was here in Nairobi was very pleasant, and it's very good to see how much progress the city and your country have done. Also, thanks to the opening remarks by the executive director of UNEP, and also thank my panelist companions. And once again, thanking the government of Kenya, the UNEA presidency, and UNEP for the warm welcome in Nairobi and the opportunity for, as one of the organizers of the UN conference, to be here to address you. We think that UN Ocean Conference is the most important event that will take place. We have seen other mentions, and I will do that also, but we have seen the number of events that we can connect to oceans issues, but we think that, and you will forgive me for that, to consider that the Ocean Conference that will be held in June is the most important event that will take place this year. It has already been mentioned that this is an event that is co-organized by Portugal and Kenya, and allow me to express my thanks to the government of Kenya, to the members of the Kenyan team that have been traveling to Lisbon to work together with us on the cooperation that we have received from you, and also, of course, from the UN Secretariat and from the Special Envoy for the Sea. You all know that the conference will be held not on a virtual method, but presential So we think that the conditions in Lisbon are already there now, and especially in from the 27th to the 1st of July, we are sure that we can present you with all the conditions for a good stay in Lisbon. When the process kicked off, we asked ourselves why we do need a new ocean conference. And the answer was very simple. Because the deadline set by the Agenda 2030 is fast approaching, and no one can tackle the challenges of sustainable development alone. If in 2017, in the first UN Ocean Conference, awareness was raised to unprecedented levels, now, as half of the targets of Goal 14 on the conservation and sustainable use of the ocean already matured, it's time to act, and with an irrefutable sense of urgency. The theme of the fifth UNEA, strengthening actions for nature to achieve the sustainable development goals, identifies 4-point actions which are intrinsically connected to SDG 14 and the ocean. Nature for jobs and economic prosperity by putting forward an agenda for a sustainable blue economy and its potential for job creation. Nature for health, emphasizing the protection of oceans and freshwater ecosystems and advocating for an holistic approach to health, bringing ocean health and human health, and focusing on a global response to address the marine and plastic pollution. And I, as the previous speakers have mentioned, I salute the agreement that was reached, I understand, yesterday on plastic pollution. Nature for climate, underlining the solutions that nature, and specifically its marine environment, can provide in adaptation and mitigation of climate change. And finally, nature for sustainable food systems, promoting sustainable practices and moving towards a sustainable production of food and commodities, mainly through fisheries and aquaculture. The transversal nature of the ocean is also highlighted by the fact that the UN Ocean Conference will be the culmination of a relevant cycle of UN events and of the need to create synergies among the relevant processes. Starting off with the United Nations Environment Assembly, that we hope marks a turning point by agreeing the agreement that was reached on plastic production and marine plastic pollution. In relation to biodiversity loss, we expect that in Kunming we'll be steady in our ambition to contemplate the international target of conservation of 30% of the marine environment, another element of the climate-ocean nexus. With the BBNJ negotiations, we expect to fill the gaps on international ocean governments directed at presenting the marine environment, the sustainability of resources, and the conservation of ecosystems. The science decision-making interface will also be decisive, and we are committed to the United Nations Decade of Ocean Science and Sustainable Development and Ecosystems Restoration, processes that go hand in hand with the new model of ocean governance and that we need to evaluate together. We will seek to build on the outcomes of the first conference and at the same time to explore synergies and raw inputs from other processes, such as the high-level panel for sustainable blue economy, the Our Oceans conferences, and the recent One Ocean Summit. But also, the UN conference will be a call for action. As UN Secretary General Guterres put it, we ask delegations to bring a plan, not a speech. This call is clear for the theme of the conference, scaling up ocean actions based on science and innovation for the implementation of Goal 14, stocktaking, partnerships, and solutions. It underlines the sense of urgency and the need to galvanize political impetus towards concrete solutions. The conference will comprise a high-level segment, plenary meetings, and 8 interactive dialogues. As a political outcome, the conference shall adopt an action-oriented declaration focusing on the science-based and innovative areas of action to support the implementation of Goal 14. The declaration is being negotiated in New York under the leadership of Denmark and Grenada. Marine pollution, protection and restore marine and coastal ecosystem, ocean acidification, fisheries, blue economy, and marine technology transfer were among the themes of the first UN Ocean Conference. Most of them will be under scrutiny again. Moreover, the nexus, ocean climate, shall also be at the center of the discussions to support ambition actions to minimize and mitigate the adverse effects of climate change. Continuous dialogue on climate change adaptation is critical, particularly for Africa and small island developing states. Implementation of innovative mechanisms will help build climate resilience in our communities as we pursue just energy transitions. We hope that the ocean-based solutions drawn up during the conference will form part of the discussions for the forthcoming climate change deliberations at COP27 and 28. All stakeholders in New York, Lisbon, and Nairobi are working together in an inclusive and outreaching process to ensure the active involvement of civil society, namely the scientific community, academia, private sector, financial and corporate, non-governmental organizations, and youth. To have a truly game-changing conference focused on tangible and action-oriented results, it is not only crucial to have strong cooperation among the states and the UN, but also to ensure the strong engagement of all major stakeholders. To that end, we are planning several events at the margins of the UN conference. The Sustainable Blue Investment and Innovation Forum that aims at creating a stronger cooperation between the private sector and the blue economy, and a youth forum to promote the involvement of spreading of knowledge on ocean issues and science among younger generations. Likewise, the sustainability of the ocean cannot be separated from sustainable management of water, nor can water be managed sustainably if we do not protect the ocean. Despite this natural cycle, the governance of seawater and freshwater is traditionally separated and left to different communities. It is crucial to build bridges and develop a comprehensive strategy that considers the entire water cycle. That is why we will organize the high-level symposium on water, bridging SDG 6 and SDG 14. Our expectation is that the 2022 UN conference will significantly mobilize civil society and be an opportunity to foster partnerships and among the private sector, especially by bringing on board representatives of the financial sector and from philanthropists. The UN Ocean Conference success depends, therefore, on our common capacity to inspire and to mobilize, harnessing the political will, innovative ideas, scientific knowledge, and the necessary resources to bring about a fundamental change in the way we do things, in order to ensure the conservation and sustainable use of our ocean for present and future generations. I therefore invite you all to come to Lisbon in June for the UN conference. We count on your participation and support to the conference, both by feeding into its work, but also by galvanizing wide participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Moutinho. Many thanks again to Portugal for the leadership, and on behalf of UNEP, we are delighted to join hands with you in organizing the conference. Without further delay, because we are running out of time, let me quickly invite an intervention from the floor, a couple of interventions from the floor. And first, starting by Mrs. Bérangère Abba, Secretary of State for Biodiversity France, to reflect on the success of the summit, One Ocean Summit, that I had the honor to attend in Brest a month ago. Please take the floor.
Thanks. Dear colleagues, first, I would like to thank Portugal and Kenya for this leadership. And I'm particularly honored to be here to address one of the most crucial issues of the time. The ocean is indeed one of the main reservoirs of biodiversity in the world, and the services its ecosystem provides to humanity, as carbon sink or food resource to a large part of humanity, is our life insurance. However, it's clear that we do not respect it enough. The ocean is threatened by many pressures that are well known: pollution, overfishing, including illegal fishing, but also climate change. These pressures are all the consequences of our practices. So we've got a real and strong responsibility to fix it. And to prepare this mobilization on the road to Lisbon, France has organized the One Ocean Summit, which was held in Brest in February, and this special event of the French presidency of the European Union Council was to make a moment for proactive European policy for ocean. The main objective of this summit was to give a strong signal to the international agenda on maritime challenges. At Brest, many participants have taken action to preserve biodiversity, stop overexploitation of marine resources, fight pollution, and mitigate climate change. New countries joined the High Ambition Coalition to protect 30% of the seas and salt. And the European Union and France launched the High Ambition Coalition on Biodiversity Beyond National Jurisdiction for BBNG in order to foster the conclusion this year of an effective global agreement. We'll see in New York next month. France and Colombia launched a global coalition for Blue Carbon too. And of course, UNEA 5 is an important moment to protect ocean from plastic pollution. I hope that we can collectively be able to establish an intergovernmental negotiating committee with a strong mandate to prepare a legally binding global agreement covering all the life cycle of plastics in a circular economy approach. So, dear colleagues and friends, One Ocean Summit, Palau, Lisbon, BBNG, COP15 give us a unique opportunity. Let's restore a blue planet. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And as we are heading to Lisbon, let me also, after UNEA, from Brest to UNEA, and then before Lisbon, we will have another important milestone. And this will be our Oceans Conference hosted by Palau and the US. And with that, I would like now to share a video message from the distinguished senator from Rhode Island, Mr. Sheldon Whitehouse. Please.
Hi, this is Senator Sheldon Whitehouse. Thank you so much to the governments of Kenya and Portugal for hosting this Road to Lisbon event in the lead up to the UN Ocean Conference in June. I'm very pleased to be a part of today's event, and I'm excited to travel to Lisbon for the conference this summer. I also very much appreciate France's leadership in hosting the One Ocean Summit in Brest earlier this month. The Our Oceans Conference, which will be hosted by the United States and Palau in April, serves as a critical milestone and opportunity for collaboration. And we need strong international collaboration to save our oceans. The clock is ticking, and there isn't a moment to lose. One problem that I've focused on for years has been plastic pollution, which in the United States Senate is a uniquely bipartisan issue. During my time in the Senate, with Senator Sullivan, I introduced and passed the Save Our Seas and Save Our Seas 2.0 acts, not only with colleagues from both sides of the aisle, but by unanimous consent. SOS 2.0 aims to improve America's ability to clean up waste, advance international cooperation, and explore innovative ways to manage and even reuse plastic waste. It builds on the success of our earlier bill, which promoted interagency coordination and helped states access resources for marine debris response. Of course, ocean plastic pollution is a global problem. Every year, 8 million metric tons of plastic enters the ocean, the equivalent of a garbage truck full of plastic trash every single minute. I'm hopeful that an international negotiating committee will be agreed to at this UNEA meeting so that we can focus on aggressively combating this global problem with global solutions. I'm very pleased to see such strong international support for cleaning up our oceans. If that support can stay strong through the summits ahead, I am optimistic that we can make real progress. We cannot delay action any longer. Thank you.
And now, there are some major moments in support of ocean action happening at UNEA as we speak. And we are so pleased to hear more about this from Mrs. Laskimi Diwanti, Vice President of UNEA and Senior Advisor to the Minister of Environment and Forestry of Indonesia. You have the floor, please.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me the floor. First of all, let me congratulate the government of Kenya and Portugal for this very interesting yet important side event on sustainable ocean. As one of the countries of at the very front forefront of marine protection, Indonesia is of the view that a healthy marine environment is a key to sustainable development. Following up UNEA's resolutions on protections of the marine environment from land-based activities and on sustainable management of global health of mangrove, Indonesia continues to strengthen its commitment and implement policies and programs on sustainable seas and oceans. Indonesia has already a commitment to achieve a target of marine protected area covering an area of 32.5 million hectares by 2030. Until last year, it has succeeded in reaching an area of 28.9 million hectares. So we are optimistic that the target can be fulfilled. Indonesia is also committed to reduce 70% of marine plastic waste by 2025. Various efforts continue to be carried out, starting from an action plan for handling marine plastic waste to the construction of a power plant made from waste. The mangrove ecosystem is also a concern. Indonesia is targeting the rehabilitation of 600,000 hectares of mangroves by 2024. All of this effort will not only have an impact on the preservation of the marine environment and sustainable development, but also on climate change. At COP26 last year, with the Archipelagic and Island State Forum countries, Indonesia has called the importance of the link between the oceans and climate change. Indonesia believes that with international support, archipelagic countries and small island countries can be part of the solution. At the global levels, Indonesia continues to support the mainstreaming of marine and ocean issues. Indonesia G20 presidency this year will highlight the importance of unique coastal and marine ecosystems, blue economy, blue carbon, and handling marine debris. Indonesia is ready to partner with all parties for the realization of sustainable marine ecosystem and sustainable oceans. So to conclude, I would like to wish the very best for the success of the 2022 United Nations Ocean Conference. I thank you.
Thank you very much. And now let me take us to our final speaker of today. And I would now love to hear from Mr. Ed Shepherd, Senior Global Sustainability Manager, Unilever, for his thoughts on how private sector and business will take responsibility and help the international community to transform business in a more friendly perspective with the environment. You have the floor, please.
Thank you, and thanks for the opportunity to speak here today as we build momentum towards the Lisbon conference. I wanted to share a short perspective from the business community on a critical issue related to ocean's health, that of plastic pollution. The uncomfortable truth for Unilever is that some of our plastic packaging ends up in the environment, and that's not okay. We've set ambitious commitments to address this, but significant roadblocks remain. Voluntary initiatives, including the UNEP Ellen MacArthur Foundation Global Commitment, have laid the pathway for change, But it is now clear that voluntary initiatives alone will not go far or fast enough to solve the issue. We must shift to mandatory policy to tackle plastic pollution at scale and source and serve the needs of our consumers. Establishing a meaningful UN treaty on plastic pollution is a vital step in this journey. Unilever supports the development of a legally binding treaty that includes both upstream and downstream interventions. We see this global instrument as an enabler of progress for business, supporting companies to pioneer new packaging innovations, including reuse and refill formats, and coordinate investment and infrastructure development to ultimately prevent leakage to the environment. It will provide certainty to the business community on the direction of travel, building confidence to scale solutions. This is a shared ambition within the business community, with over 100 leading companies calling for the establishment of a legally binding treaty that includes both upstream and downstream interventions. The UN Ocean Conference in June will be an important milestone as we seek to build engagement across stakeholders towards this goal, and we look forward to engaging further on this important topic for the ocean's health. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And after running this different perspectives from governments, from business, from industry, it's really impressive to see how much momentum we have at this point for oceans. And as we are heading for the end of our panel, I would like now to bounce back the ball for you, to you, Peter, to introduce your final words, actually, and a video that we have to share with our audience today.
Okay, I haven't seen the video yet, so I'm looking forward to that. But let me just finish up then. I know we're running short of time. On connectivity, basically, and if you look at connectivity, think of the generations. I'm a grandfather to three beautiful granddaughters. It's the reason that I do what I do, the connectivity, the continuity of our responsibilities for as long as we can before we hand over the baton to them to keep doing that work, right, which I referred to earlier. Think about the connectivity of the Paris Agreement and the Sustainable Development Goals. You know, these are universally agreed between all our nations, and they are in effect the blueprint for the survival of our species on this planet taken together. That's our plan. What else do we have? So that connectivity. Think of the within the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda, and we have the co-chair of the Sustainable Development Committee that brought them into existence with us here, Ambassador Kamal. That is a program which is totally connected. It takes everything and puts it all together. The 17 Sustainable Development Goals are a carefully crafted package. SDG 14 resides within them. Think about the connectivity of all our international efforts. And here, you know, the connectivity of actually being in person is so important. I had the privilege of being at the One Ocean Summit in Brest at the beginning of this month. And my God, that was an incredibly successful meeting. You know, 3 days, the output was amazing. Have a look at the website of the One Ocean Summit output statement, and you'll be amazed at what was achieved by those 40 heads of government who took part in over 100 countries. And from there, of course, we go on to the, as was mentioned, the Our Oceans Conference in Palau, and from there onwards to the UN Ocean Conference. But of course, it doesn't stop there. The connectivity continues, the responsibilities continue. So everybody, it was just really great to be here in person with you all again, because that there's a power in this human interaction, as I'm sure you're all feeling. And you're probably wondering what this thing sitting in my lap is. This is the Nature's Baton, which has been traveling now around the world at ocean meetings, mainly by yacht, mainly by sail. I sailed it from Barcelona across to Marseille for the IUCN World Conservation Congress last September. It traveled from Southampton up to Glasgow for COP26 by a bicycle relay. We sailed it into Brest for the One Ocean Summit. It'll go out to Palau. I brought it down here, having to buy some offset miles to get it here. But this will eventually sail into Lisbon Harbor, where you'll all see it again at the UN Ocean Conference at the end of June. So everybody, see you all in Lisbon.
And colleagues, organizers, I promised, oh, sorry.
Yes, you have to introduce the screen video about the tide turners. So please, I hope you are with me. I promise you twice that we'll have a video. Fight plastic pollution. You will see an amazing experience with them.
Most of our programs actually focus on how do we better the environment. Scouts are exposed to innovations that they didn't know before. When you're talking about plastic recycling, plastics reuse.
The plastic tide turners has helped me become aware of the various ways through which plastic pollutes the environment. In curbing plastic pollution, it involves the three R's, that is reusing, recycling and reducing. It's hard to reduce the use of plastic, but it's very easy to recycle and to reuse. The plastic tide turners was able to help me impact on the environment of the school and the neighborhood at large, because we were able to undertake a public awareness campaign on plastic pollution and on the measures on how to prevent plastic pollution. Also, as the Junior Achievement Club, we took up several cleanups in the school and in the neighborhood where we collected plastics and called a recycling company who were able to take the bottles. In reusing the plastics, we can make creative pieces of art from plastic materials like plastic straws, plastic papers, plastic bottles.
And these are things that now the scouts are more aware and they are keener to continue promoting a culture of making sure that the environment is clean, that they are able to recycle and reuse from a very basic level to a very executive level.
So I'm an optimist. Why? Because I see young people in the street, young people engaging and fighting for a cleaner environment. And here at UNEA, we're particularly pleased with Tide Turners, working with the youth movement to turn around pollution. This badge, which is now available, is made entirely from recycled materials. So earn this badge and engage communities, engage with schools, set up training programs, and learn how you can influence policy for better and safer environment. That's it, that's what we need to do. Turn the tide, all hands on deck.
Have a nice day.